I find it particularly disappointing when I see what amounts to consumer farming in large arenas of Chinese art in YouTube, whereby a few factions blitz post movies in a swamping manner that produces a blanket impression that in turn forces an artificialism against the real impression of the Chinese arts. By so doing, and also by becoming sect-driven hatemongers whose responses to Western requests in some sectors are little short of suicidal racism, by clearly stating, look what we can do, but hands off, means that unfortunately the Western ignorance of the Chinese arts is being driven ever deeper into Room 101. I've already named, proved, and shamed these offenders in a video on YouTube, so I won't expand on this old, rather boring news again. It is disgusting to say the least that Europe is so China deaf and China blind. I've gone into several towns in England and directly asked store owners, why is there nothing in here associated with the Chinese arts? To which they take me to a hidden shelf and point out a small jam jar with some £7.50 shaggy little Chinese brushes in that they bought from Guanghua in London Chinatown anyway for about 80 pence. One even went so far as to admit this. A store in Winchester, the woman there actually got so hot under the collar, I thought she was going to hit me. She literally boiled, and all I said was, regarding the fact that Chinese arts started the world's movement in the field, and despite the fact that they had art and writing thousands of years before the West, why have you only got two tourist calligraphy kits on sale, and 9 tiny brushes in an old used jam jar? Does that sum up your understanding of Chinese art, or is it a racist issue that you will not stock Chinese materials? I don't use much sensitivity to people who, after a polite request, act as if I just threw shit in their faces because I simply wanted to know if they knew what an inkstone was, or I ask, do you sell ink sticks, to which they respond, do you mean solid paints? Oh no, we only use the best Roni tubes. It's changing slowly, but only insofar as the Chinese themselves are doing it for themselves. Let's face it, it's not going to happen any other way. They're opening stores and brightly coloured market shops selling Chinese goods. Okay, they're a bit Western in trend, but it's a start, and face it, the Europeans act as though they invented the earth anyway. So I find it refreshing to see the Chinese getting up and saying, excuse me, but we do exist. On the art side of things, well, I was pleasantly refreshed to see in my space a massive number of people who post their paintings. They don't do YouTube. They don't have videographic skills, or maybe the software, but they do photograph their work, albeit in a very ropey, poor quality manner, but it does display their paintings. That's all that matters. And next month I'll do an in-depth study of some of what I see as the more prominent artists in MySpace, because they need displaying here, and they need a megaphone for their artistic voices. I'd like to play that part for a while. The images here, while I have not edited them to enhance their colour, are from MySpace by majority and display a pleasant confidence in spontaneous and contemporary artistic angles from a Chinese point of view by the Chinese. That's important. That in itself is a massive leap forwards, and I have to say, it's a shame that there isn't the same number of Chinese artists in YouTube that there are in MySpace. But that's because YouTube is for movies. A lot of these artists are artists, and they don't have the software, or they don't understand how to create a videographic slideshow. I would suggest that the cure to this, YouTube made a system, if they haven't already, that allows users to upload images into an application that allows a talkover and a slideshow effect and or, and then posted the resulting slideshow movie, because this would massively increase what, at the moment, amounts to a rather restricted by comparison level of Chinese art influence. Our one hope in England anyway is Guanghua in London Chinatown, the history of which I'll research later this year, but they are incredible. Literature specialist store in London Piccadilly, Chinatown, they have a massive cellar downstairs that's solid with Chinese art, literature, materials, and everything else. It's a complete paradise of Chinese influence, frequented also by London Chinese artists. Let's hope they're recognised one day by someone who at least has the influence to start acknowledging their position in the art fields of Europe, so that the shielded Europeans are allowed open eyes to see a side to creativity and expressionism that otherwise they've been denied through conditioned ignorance and creative suffocation for the profit of commercialistic conditioning and sheep farming. That attitude by the European art material dealers is identical to what I see as a reversed angle in YouTube regarding a flooding of Chinese art impression by the initial mentioned for the gains of spam farmers to their own ends. It's as if the powers that be are working on either ends of the spectrum, one to deny the ability to appreciate Chinese arts and the other to deny and stunt the scope of Chinese artistic expressionism. My aim here is to speak in a no-nonsense message to ask those responsible for placating racism to grow up, and those responsible for the European art materials distribution in England to pull their heads out of their back ends and wake up to the real world instead of the class-obsessed, ainly buried, head-in-the-sand idiot stance on Chinese arts. Christopher Phillips, curator at the International Center of Photography in New York, has been visiting China for 8 years, looking at emerging artists in photography, video and painting, and curating exhibitions of their works. In 2004, he and Wu Hung published Between Past and Future, New Photography and Video from China. He's been going to China for almost 8 years now, looking at Chinese art and photography. He tells us when and why, and what his earliest impressions were. He first came to China in the fall of 1999 to present a series of lectures on contemporary art at Tsinghua University in Beijing. At that time, he was working as senior editor in the Art in America magazine in New York. On this, and a follow-up trip to Beijing and Shanghai in spring 2000, he made many friends of artists thanks to the generosity of Jing Danwen, Li Xiangting, and Ai Weiwei, and also Hans van Dijk. Among those artists were Wang Gongqin, Lin Tianmiao, Yang Fudong, Zhu Zhen, and Zhang Dali, Ding Yi, as well as many others. His impression of the Chinese art scene was that it was a kind of wildly pulsating field of energy that was expanding every second. He was startled by the level of imagination and inventiveness that was evident in the works he viewed. He felt immediately that this was one of those rare historic moments that comes along only once or twice a century in the art world. Now, so many years later, when asked, "How do you see Chinese contemporary art?" he says, "The world has discovered Chinese contemporary art, and the resulting changes have almost come too quickly to believe." There are artists who were living in poverty when I met them in 1999 who are now very wealthy and who employ dozens of assistants to help produce their works. However, the flood of money that's washing through the Chinese contemporary art scene hasn't really yielded better or more interesting art, only glossier production values. He finds it disheartening to visit artists today and hear very little talk about artistic question, only endless recitals of the latest auction results and gossip about whose work is or is not being purchased by mega-collectors like Charles Saatchi. If you're not directly involved in the market, this kind of talk is just mind-numbingly boring. He sees the current state of things very clearly and says that in the past 10 years, Chinese experimental artists have fought a very long, hard battle for national and international recognition. They won that battle, triumphed completely. During the next 10 years, the major artistic struggle in China will shift to another area, to the desperate need to establish stable, long-term institutions that can support contemporary art. This is a very different kind of battle, and it will involve a different group of players, many of whom won't really be practicing artists. There are still a number of Chinese artists who are continuing to push their art in new directions. For example, in the past 2 years, Zheng Fanzi has become an astonishingly accomplished oil painter, among the best in the world, actually. Others who are still breaking new ground are Zhu Zhen, Lin Tianmiao, Wang Jinsong, and Yang Fong. And although there's a lot of concern about the impact of the current art market mania on the youngest generation of Chinese artists, it's impressive with much of the work being seen in the past year. For example, the recent group exhibition, Infantilization, at the Shanghai Art Museum included works by very young artists who showed remarkable talent, skill and imagination, especially in the field of animation, which is becoming an extremely active area. In 2004, there was a major exhibition in New York of photography by some of China's leading artists. In recent years, we've heard more about oil painters, sculptors, and installation artists. So has photography faded as a major medium of expression in China, or is it just not being recognized as much? The art world spotlight is constantly turning, always in search of something new and exciting. Interest constantly rotates from medium to medium. Photography and video were super hot internationally in the late 1990s and nowhere more than China. Today the spotlight's moved and we see a surge of interest in drawing and painting everywhere. Of course, there are extremely good artists who continue year in and year out to explore a single medium, whether it's photography, or video, or installation, or performance. Chinese photo artists such as Miao Xiaochun, Xing Danwen, and Wang Qinsong are all doing better, more interesting work than they were 5 years ago. In addition, photography is such a diverse and flexible medium that many artists who don't specialize in photography can make remarkable works involving photography that change people's impressions of the way it works regarding delivering a message. Take a look at the recent book by painter Liu Xiangdong, for example. I suspect that next year we'll see Ai Weiwei present a very surprising photographic project as well. There are three artists in particular who have wide scope and ambition of their recent work. The best known of these artists are Zhang Huan, whose new paintings, woodcuts and sculptural objects are absolutely sensational. He's made an unexpected leap to an entirely new artistic level. The young animation artist Chu Anzhong has developed quickly. His promising early works have now moved to engineering long format animations that are quite amazing for their visual ingenuity and narrative drive. And Chen Yung, who is still in her early 20s, is turning very quickly into a substantial artist. She's now using her colorful pop style computer drawings to explore expansive mythical themes in a way that's visually dazzling and weirdly compelling. All three of these artists will attract growing attention in the coming years. In the coming year, there's a show called Shanghai Kaleidoscope, which should open in May at the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto. The exhibition will look at new urban culture that's arising in Shanghai, concentrating on the interplay between architecture, art, and fashion. It won't be an enormous exhibition, but it will try to suggest the enormous creative energy that is reshaping 21st century Shanghai.